Let us get it going. Good evening. Welcome to today's talk by Professor B.S. Acharya in this series of online interaction lecture series, which are being organized, as you many of you know, by the INO project. And we are in the week 8. So every week we are having 3 lectures by distinguished scientists in the field of high energy physics in general. And as we also go along, we'll also try to rope in other distinguished speakers working in related areas like nuclear physics and avian physics and so on and so forth. And today's talk is titled as Universe Viewed in Gamma Rays. And Professor Acharya is going to speak on ground-based gamma ray astronomy and various experiments, and particularly the experiments in which he was involved deeply. But before I request on behalf of you, Professor Acharya, to speak on, let me say a few words about him. I'm sorry, I think I missed, So Professor Acharya did his MSc way back, of course, 1974 from University of Mysore. And then he, after a brief stint at Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics, he joined TIFR in 1975, where he did his PhD and then continued to stay on there till he retired a few years ago. Of course, he did a few postdoctoral research positions at LPT in France, University of Siegen in Germany, and NASA. And also at Fermi National Accelerator Laboratory, USA. His main areas of research, of course, spans generally high energy physics, like cosmic ray studies, high energy particle interactions. He, of course, worked both at Cavitron at Fermilab and also LHC at CERN, and the gamma ray astronomy, which, of course, mostly is going to speak today, and then the neutrino physics. And so, as I said, spanning for more than 4 decades, his research careers, he had worked on several experiments, front-ranking experiments, including cosmic ray extensive Earthshore experiment at the Kolar Goldfields, gamma ray astronomy experiments at various mountain altitudes like Uti, Pachmari, and so on, and also at Ladakh region in the Himalayas. Also, he had worked for balloon-borne cosmic ray experiments, as I said, during his days at NASA, and he had participated both at D0 at Tevatron at Fermilab, as well as early part of so-called Hauter Hadron Calorimeter of the CMS experiment at LHC, for which TIFR and other Indian institutions made significant contributions. As you know, while D0 discovered top quark, and CMS and along with Atlas, of course, discovered the Higgs boson, respectively. And the later part of his career, he, of course, was very deeply involved with the India-based Neutrino Observatory, the INO project, about which you already know, and also the gamma ray astronomy experiment, both at Henley, which I just mentioned, as well as the CTA project. So, of course, besides the physics and the deep level of his involvement in many experiments, he also held very senior administrative positions at TIFR. Like, of course, he was a chair of the Department of High Energy Physics, and he was our convener of budget planning group and several other major responsibilities. So with those few words, now I request Professor Acharya to talk on universe as viewed in gamma rays.
Okay, Satya, thank you very much. Okay. Good evening to everybody. I'm going to talk on universe viewed in gamma rays. Okay. Briefly, I'm going to tell why should we view the universe, and that too in gamma rays, and then how it could be done. Okay. That is the essence of my talk. Okay. As you know, most spacecrafts from various space agencies like our own ISRO, NASA, and so many other ISRO and other countries like that, all one have so far surveyed only the solar system, okay, but not gone beyond very much. The universe is quite big, so we cannot go there or send probes to find out directly what is happening where and other things like that. So what we have to do is we have to depend upon what comes to us, that information. So the matter in the form of cosmic rays, neutrino, dark matter, etc. are coming to us. Radiation in the form of electromagnetic radiation is coming. Gravitational waves are coming. So we have to use these probes to understand what is there in the universe. Okay. So in the electromagnetic spectrum, which is shown in the bottom panel half, it extends from radio to gamma rays. You can see that optical band is very narrow, but radio and gamma rays are quite broad. Okay. And all these wavelengths, okay, which is the energy is shown in the bottom line, and the wavelength is shown in the top line. Okay, top line here. So single technique is not possible to detect the electromagnetic radiation. These photons at different energies. Okay, the interaction mechanisms are different, and different techniques has to be used and developed. So technology also depends on availability, and that is how gamma ray astronomy took a lot of time to come. Unlike optical, is the one the first to start, and then other things like radio, X-rays, and all those things have come up. Okay, so here I have to introduce few nomenclatures. Like I'll be using 1 GeV, 10^9 electron volts, and 1 TeV, 10^12 electron volts, and 1 PeV, 10^15 electron volts, like that. Okay, so sky looks different at different wavelengths in the electromagnetic spectrum. Okay. Though extends from radio to gamma rays like that, sky is totally different at different wavelengths, and temporal and spectral information on wide band are needed to interpret the underlying astrophysics. It is not not enough if you just observe the sky with one wavelength. You have to observe it all wavelengths to understand what it is. It's not enough if you observe the sky once, because sky is dynamic. Okay, it keeps changing. So the same location or same object, if you see once, it is not enough. You have to keep on repeatedly looking at it to understand what exactly is happening there. Okay. So here in this plot, I've shown the flux of photons. Okay. The y-axis, it is the photons number, and the x-axis, it is the wavelength, and the bottom is wavelength, and in the top line, it is the energy. You can see there the radio, cosmic microwave background, they're all quite flux is quite high. These photons, these are all low energy photons. As the energy increases, it falls off. Okay, the spectrum falls off, which means basically it is like in any to give you an analogy, if you are asking for donation of 10 rupees or 100 rupees like that, there are many people who could give. But if you're asking for donation of 1 lakh or even higher amount, very few can give, because unless they have enough money, they cannot give that much money as a donation. Okay. So similarly here, unless if you are going for a higher energy photons, unless that system is energetic, it is not able to generate this kind of high energy photons like that. Okay, so their number is smaller and smaller. Okay. So therefore, the flux also comes down. Okay, the another thing which is plotted is the flux of cosmic rays, which is quite high compared to photons, which we will come back to that later as my talk proceeds. Here, the line stops at this point because it is the total energy. Cosmic rays, the proton rest mass is about a GeV, so it starts around 10^9 here, and then it goes like. Then astrophysical neutrinos also there. Okay, there's a lower energy neutrinos also there, but it is not plotted here because this is mainly for photons, and then the background from the cosmic rays like that. Okay, the next is how this. There are various processes which can produce these photons or gamma rays. Okay, these things are on Gram-Sterling, antimatter annihilation, radioactivity, Cherenkov-like effect, hot plasma. All these kind of things are lower energy photons, but I am concentrating on the higher energy photons like synchrotron radiation, where energetic electrons in a high magnetic field can give the synchrotron photons, and these synchrotron photons can with the electrons, okay, it can scatter and go to boosted up into higher energy by the inverse quantum effect. I think this picture is little wrong. It is the low energy photon coming and going as a higher energy. So this is a Compton effect. Then energy particle collision, where the cosmic rays, okay, can in interstellar medium can produce pions, and these pi zeros can decay into photons, and then pi plus can decay into muons and neutrinos like that. So you get neutrinos and gamma from this kind of. So high energy gamma rays are due to the presence of energetic electrons or protons and high magnetic fields. These are the potential sites for acceleration of cosmic rays. Then of course there are decay of dark matter if it decays into photons, or the gamma ray burst like that. Okay, these are the various ways gamma rays can be produced. As I said, the cosmic rays can interact and produce gamma and neutrinos like that. But gammas and neutrinos are the only neutral particles. Therefore, we could use them to pinpoint the direction of what happens where the cosmic ray acceleration is taking place like that. Otherwise, what is happening is cosmic rays are mostly charged particles. So they get bent by the interstellar magnetic field or intergalactic magnetic field or at the environment of the magnetic field like that. Okay. So by the time they come to us, they lose their original direction. So we can't point back unless they are very high energy cosmic rays. Okay. Then if they are within our galaxy, like 10^18 electron volts or 10^19 electron volts, if they are within our galaxy, within galaxy which is producing, then maybe they can be pointing back to the site of their origin. That is possible. But otherwise, most of the cosmic rays, you can't use their pointing direction and find out from where they have come. We can't find out. You have to rely upon photons or the neutrinos. Okay. Then let's see, how do we detect these photons? Okay, gamma. Everybody knows how the photons interact with matter, like photoelectric absorption, inverse Compton, this is Compton effect, and then also through pair production. So I'm talking about high energy ones, and mostly they are all pair production. Okay, so you have to detect electron positron and then work backwards to the photon. But then you see the electromagnetic radiation in the X-rays, UV and gamma, they're all energetic. We can't expose our body into this kind of energetic particles. We can't expose yourself to an X-ray machine just like that. So therefore, nature has provided us shield, that is the atmosphere. So because of that, what is happening is these particles, they get attenuated, they are absorbed in the atmosphere, or their energy is come down. So it's only in the optical as well as in the radio and other things, atmosphere is completely transparent. You can do it in the ground. Otherwise, if you want to detect these particles, these gamma rays, either you have to go on a mountain altitudes or airplane altitudes, okay, or balloon, okay, about 50 kilometers or so with a balloon, or further, you can go for a satellite, okay, satellite-based detectors. So in that case, you can see the directly photons can be detected. Okay. So there were satellites. 1970, for the earlier satellite was started, it had only detected a couple of sources. Then in the 80s, Cosby satellite had detected around 12 sources. then Compton Gamma-ray Observatory had an EGRET experiment in the 1995. That's about 120 or so about such things. But now currently, this Fermi, okay, Fermilat, Large Area Telescope, that is this one, okay, where the photon is coming and it is giving a positron-electron pair. There is a silicon tracker which is getting its track, and then the calorimeter to find their energy. Okay, their energy is determined, the track, and then the angle between them is determined, and use the kinematics, they find the direction of the gamma, energy of the gamma, and all this. They have seen, this is shown in a galactic coordinate, that is, this is the horizontal line in the center, is the galactic plane, and then mostly other extra galactic objects, other galactic objects, they're all uniformly distributed. So one has seen about about 5,700 such objects. This is plotted here, it's only 3,033. It's a third catalog, and this is the fourth one has recently generated there. Since 2008, it was launched, this satellite was, and it has been collecting data for such a long time. Okay. So there are a variety of objects like pulsars, binaries, then active galactic nuclei, supernova remnants, and all those kind of things. Okay. One problem though, in the sense, right now the current satellite can go up to 1 TeV, mostly around about 300 GeV or so, but can go to 1 TeV energy. Okay. Now, if you cannot go to higher and higher energy, as the year passes from 1970 to this one, they slowly, the technology improved, and heavier payloads could be launched. Therefore, the detector technology is also improved. Therefore, one was able to launch. So this is a 2 meter by 2 meter detector, and is about 3 tons. Okay, weight is like that. Now, if you want to go to higher energy, still higher energy photon, as I said, that as the energy increases, their number is falling off. So therefore, if you need the higher energy, then you have to have a larger area telescope, and you have to operate it for much longer time. So either you put this kind of telescopes in a space station or in a moon or in our on the moon, you put it like that, then it may be possible. Until that kind of technology works out, it can be done through the ground. But I said the atmosphere is there to attenuate this photon. So therefore, when you are doing it from the ground, it is indirectly you are detecting. Okay, that is the what happens in the ground is air has become the detector. Okay, the phone is coming, it produces the E plus E minus pair, but these are all energetic particles, and they produce a Bremsstrahlung gamma. Okay, and this photon again produces an electron positron pair. So that kind of things keeps on going on. Okay, at each time the energy of the particle becomes less and less. This kind of things happens in the hadrons also, that is cosmic rays also, that is proton and so many other elements of the what you see in the periodic table. All those elements in the cosmic rays, they come, they interact in the nucleus, they produce all the secondary pions and secondary particles, and they also, some of them decay, some of them interact further, and the cascade keeps on going. Okay, and it is so if the electromagnetic cascade has been modeled by Baba and Hettler, that is one photon coming and split into two, it has energy E here, and it becomes E by 2 on the average. This one, then it becomes E4, okay, on the average, like that. Each time it gets degraded and their number increases. But then their number cannot increase continuously. It keeps increasing. Concentrate on one of this curve here, let's say 120 TeV here. Their number, to start with 1, this is at the top of the atmosphere in the x-axis, is 0 is top of the atmosphere, and this is sea level, okay, around. This is the number of such particles in the shower. To start with, you have 1. one incident particle, and their number keeps on increasing as the shower develops. And then after some time, it reaches some maximum number. And then beyond that, it cannot, that electron positrons cannot generate a bremsstrahlung because they start losing their energy by ionization. That becomes more dominant. And the photon also cannot, after some time, cannot be able to generate E plus C minus pair. Okay. So then onwards, the cascade particles start getting absorbed atmosphere, because atmosphere is rare in the beginning and it becomes denser and denser. The air is denser and denser near the sea level. Okay, the one atmosphere near the sea level. As you go up, the pressure is much, much less. Okay, keep going down. So as it comes down and down, it keeps interacting with more and more nucleus. Therefore, it gets absorbed. So here you can see, in some cases, okay, this numbers mean it is incident energy, 10 to the power 16 electron volts, like that. Okay, if the incident energy of the particle is sufficiently high, it can give a sizable number of particles at the sea level, charged particles in the sea level. Now these charged particles in the sea level can be detected, and one can do that. But then there are things, if the incident energy is lower, it doesn't, the shower does not even reach the ground. Okay, the sea level, it gets absorbed before that. So in such kind of cases also, now there is another effect. This is a secondary electromagnetic shower production, is incident particle producing this charged particle shower. Okay, that is secondary effect. Then the tertiary effect is, there is a charged particles, this kind of charged particles, electrons, muons, like that, or in the case of gamma, it is only electrons and positrons. They can produce in air what is called Cherenkov light, which is in the visible region. Just like in the super Kamiokande, the muon is being detected in a water. The neutrino comes and gives a muon and or electron, depending upon what type of neutrino it is. And these charged particles, they give, as they move in the water, they produce Cherenkov light, and it is picked up by the photomultiplier or light detector, like that. So this Cherenkov effect is there in the water, in the air, in the ice, like ice cube. They all use the Cherenkov effect like that. Okay. So it is shown here simply, a shower is coming, means a gamma ray has come from the source, from the same direction, and the shower is about angle of about a degree or so, okay, along the axis of the shower, and which by the time it comes to the ground, it is spread out to about 100 to 150 meter radius. So it's almost like a collection area becomes much larger. Okay, so here it is, I have shown that in the case of satellite, what you are measuring is, you are measuring directly photons. So the photons has to come and pass through the detector. So the physical area of the detector is the collection area. Whereas in this case, in the ground, what happens is the air is the detector. It produces a shower, and therefore it gets amplified, okay, that collection area, because it becomes like a cone. And then by the time it hits, even though physical area of the detector, the light sensor what you have put, this is put a mirror here, and collect this light and focus this light into this light collector. Okay, so this light collector can be triggered by all these photons which has come far away. So basically the collection area, you get almost four orders of magnitude larger than the physical area what is there in satellite. Therefore you can detect higher energy photons using the ground. But then the price what you are paying is, this is a tertiary effect. The initial photon has come and that has produced a shower, and that shower gives a, that shower charged particles as they pass through the medium, it is the medium produces this Cherenkov light, and therefore all these things has to be worked out with the Monte Carlo simulations and all those things. But it is possible to detect this gamma rays using this. So to update you okay, this gamma rays in the satellite, direct measurement of the photons. Now, in the satellite detectors, they have a anti-coincident shield to block out all the cosmic rays, charged particles, because they have much more background cosmic particles than the photons, like that. They can typically go up to, nowadays, can go up to 1 TeV. Then there are the one from 50 GeV to about 50 TeV or so. The shower is produced in the atmosphere, but the shower is not reached. So in that case, Cherenkov light, optical light is emitted, and that can be utilized using the mirror and can be detected. Now this, okay, I'm going to talk about only this case. Third case is where the energy of the gamma rays is still higher, about 100 TeV or more, and where in that case, the charged particles can reach the ground. So in that case, you can put a scintillator, okay, or some other charged particle detectors, and they can be detected all 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, throughout the year, like that. We have one such experiment in by TIFR and Osaka City University of Japan at Uti. Okay. So I was talking about only these cases where the in all these cases Cherenkov light is produced. But the Cherenkov light is produced even in daytime also with the shower, but they are so feeble, you can't detect it. So detect the Cherenkov light, you need to have a dark night. Okay, you can't do it in daytime because sunlight is too much. Then you can't do it even when the moon is there. Now, fortunately for us, we have only one moon, and that moon also does not rise as when sun sets. It happens only in the full moon. When the sun sets, immediately the moon rises and the moon is there for the whole night. But in the new moon days, the whole night is dark. Amavasya days, the whole night is dark. So we can typically observe from 10 days before, 10 or 15 days, 10 days before the new moon and 10 days after, like that. Then the observation time is also depending upon either the after moon rise or moon set, okay, whatever the dark part is there, like that. So as I said, because one moon is only one moon we have, therefore experiment can be done on Earth. But if you have a case like a Jupiter where there are many moons, it cannot be done. Even this part of the experiment cannot be done. Okay. Now here, okay, I'll be talking about this experiment. It is in Hanle in Ladakh. This is the observatory by the Indian Institute of Astrophysics in Bangalore, and this is a telescope, meter Chandra telescope, optical telescope there, operated by them. And this is in the ground. This is the Hagar experiment using the atmospheric Cherenkov technique. This is a Uti. Okay. So in the little bit of early history, okay, I said earlier that in the 70s, this satellite experiment started. And I showed a graph where the satellite experiments started and all those things like that. But the ground-based observations have started much before. Okay, the first experiment was done in the mid-50s by the Russian group. Okay. But in India, after the discovery of the pulsar in 1969, the first experiment was done with a very small mirror, about a foot in diameter, like that, and two photomultipliers did, okay, sometimes. So those days, what happens is the sensitivity of these experiments are quite poor, in the sense their threshold energy is quite large, and the direct observation by the satellite or by the balloon like that were only few MeV or GeV gamma rays. So from GeV to 1 TeV or 10 TeV like that, you need to extrapolate some 3-4 orders of magnitude. Okay. Therefore, there used to be much confusion about what kind of sources to observe and things like that. But slowly, slowly, with the addition, as the money was available and as the technology developed, more and more and bigger mirrors were added. And in Uti, there was an experiment 1975 to 85, then in Pachmari in 86 to 2000, like that. Then this is by the TIFR groups, and then BRC, they had a at a very high altitude in Gulmarg, they had a experiment with, again, 6 meter experiments like that. But later, as the technology improved further in the recent past, we had at Pachmari for 10 years, we have 25 distributed telescopes, okay, in a meter, about 100 meter by 100 meter ground, like that. Each mirror, each telescope had 7 mirrors and about a 1 meter diameter mirrors, and viewed by single photo multiplier, like that. Whereas BRC group had at Mount Abu, okay, they had this system with the tactic telescope system. This one, it is still being used. It is still being used. And this had many 300 photo multipliers at the center, and it's about a 30 centimeter mirrors. Many such mirrors are put like that. And the experiment has been still continuing. Okay. Now, another way to cost effective way of reducing the energy threshold. If you reduce the energy threshold, then the flux of photons is larger. Okay, their flux is increasing as the energy is going down, as the energy goes down, or in other sense, flux is falling off when the energy is higher. So you can keep on reduce the energy threshold. So in that case, you have more the possibility of detection of such objects. So if you see in this one, from the sea level, if you go up, you get the density of photons are much more here compared to this one, because it is the same photon which is coming down, which is distributed over lesser area. So collection area goes down, but energy threshold increases. So lateral distribution is shown here for different altitudes. You get an advantage of the same, operating the same size of the detector at high altitudes, you can go down in the energy and increase the sensitivity. That's how we moved from Pachmari to Hanle. Okay, it is about 4.3.
Looks like there is some network problem. We'll wait for a couple of minutes. Line got disconnected, in fact. Maybe he's trying to connect it again. It looks like you got logged out. I mean, the thing got disconnected. Yeah. Same, you click on the same link. Okay, now you are back in. Back in, but you have to share the screen again.
Okay.
Just a second. You can share it again.
So up to what point we have heard?
You were just talking about lowering the threshold.
Okay.
You want
okay.
to go to higher altitude.
Okay. This is the point. Okay, so earlier we are at Pachmari and Mount Abu, and
Acharya, since you are at this point, I think Hariom had a question. Hariom, do you want to ask? Fine. Yeah, you can go ahead, Acharya.
So this is at Hanle. This is operate this observatory belongs to Indian Institute of Astrophysics, and they are also part of this experiment. And this project is actually started with the TIFR and Indian Institute of Astrophysics. Later on, DRC and Saha Institute, they're all involved. Okay, so this is the first phase, because we wanted by the time the Fermilab is launched, it is in orbit, so we could lower energy threshold. This is about 200 GeV, our threshold energy is, so that we can monitor some of the objects from the satellite vision without much extrapolation. Yeah, so this is construction started in 2005. Some telescopes, first telescopes were built in Bangalore and tested in Bangalore IAEA, and later on shipped to Hanley. And from 2005 to 2008, the construction took place, and all the seven such telescopes were in operation, and we have started observing. It is still working. And we are regularly observing it since 2008. This is the data acquisition system, tracking system for all the telescopes. We have observed many sources, mainly pulsars and active galactic nuclei, transient, like that. We have been concentrating on that kind of sources. Okay. Then this, as I said, the BRC is also involved. So they are putting a another one bigger telescope called MACE, at 21 meter diameter, bigger imaging telescope in the same area. Now, Hanley, I said it's a cold desert region. There are no power lines. There is no electricity. You have to generate your own electricity. There are solar power plants. Sunlight is plenty there, so you can get the power. And also, if there are cloudy, then you have to have diesel generators to get a power line. Okay, so this is the MACE. So MACE also done by this ECIL, and it is done by BRC, but the construction and other things is partly done by ECIL, okay, by supervised by the BRC. Various departments like that. It was tested in Hyderabad first, and then dismantled and recommissioned in Hanley. Okay, so it is almost last year it was complete. It is completed, and there were some minor problems with that. But last year they did from the Crab Nebula, the gamma rays. I think from this year they would be doing the regular observations. Okay, this is the subsystem of the MACE telescope. This is a 21 meter diameter, and the whole height is about 45 meters. Okay, height. It is a huge this one, and mechanical structure is about 150 ton. Kind of thing. And here, the small 1 meter by 1 meter kind of panels are there, and they are all about 360 such panel. Each panel has four 50 centimeter by 50 centimeter ones. Mirrors are there like this, and then it is viewed by 108 PRTs in this one. So what happens is, here when you put a, instead of single photon, if you put a single photon, photomultiplier or light sensor, what happens is you are detecting the light integrated over the all the longitudinal development of the shower. So you don't get the longitudinal development, you get only the lateral distribution. If you have many such telescopes spread around in the ground, you get a lateral spread out. Okay, but if you put many light sensors here, and then if you put only one telescope like this, then what happens is you get a longitudinal development, you see, but you miss the lateral this, because there is no lateral symmetry, okay, in the shower development. We will come to that. So here the energy threshold is around 40 GeV or so. Okay, so there are other telescopes which has been working in the world for quite some time, and recently they have introduced quite a few objects like that. The northern hemisphere, you can see a different sky compared to southern hemisphere. There is that the northern hemisphere, the major detectors are MAGIC collaboration. It is in La Palma, in the island here, is controlled by the Spain. It is a 17 meter diameter mirrors. Again, there are many photo multipliers. They're all imaging type. They get the image of the shower development like that. Okay. And then in Arizona, in America, there are four telescopes of 12 meter diameter like that. Okay. Of that order. Like this. And then in southern hemisphere, started with four and finally this is 28 meter diameter. This is the largest telescope right now. These are all about 12 meter diameters ones. Okay, southern sky, you can, the advantage is you can see the galactic center, you can see it. Okay. Now another thing in this atmospheric Cherenkov work, this method of observing, you are working in the night, and also as the earth rotates, this object which you are doing, it comes to overhead at some point, and after some time it goes below your region. So typically you can observe 3 hours before it passes overhead and 3 hours after that, before and after. So it becomes something like 6 hours of per object you can observe at one point. So if you want to monitor a source 24 hours from ground, then what you have to do is you have to have different stations at a different longitudinal level, so that it is separated by about 6 hours. Okay, in the longitude, 24 hours of this one, you can have one in Japan, one somewhere in India, China, or in this Russia like that, and one here and one in this. Similarly like that, okay? Yeah. So single detector cannot observe continuously, okay? You can observe, so what happens is some of these objects are transient, they flare, this and that. So unless you have to observe 24 hours continuously, only then you can see it. Otherwise, if you are lucky, you will see it. Otherwise, you don't. Okay. So, putting all those detectors, different stations like that, I said that in the satellite, anyway, they have seen something like about 6,000 point sources of various types. So, now one can talk about class of such objects, and one can do the astrophysics of that kind of type of objects like that. In the ground-based observatories, though work has started in the mid-50s like that, but the real detection of permanent detection of Crab Nebula took place in around 1990 by the Whipple Observatory in Arizona, in America, and then onwards by adding quite a few imaging telescopes and other telescopes like that. Nowadays, it's about 250 or so such sources have been detected. And again, the class of such sources are pulsars, micro quasars or X-ray binaries, supernova remnants, then active galactic nuclei. These are the major kind of sources. And then there are other sources also. Okay. So, now to improve the sensitivity of the current operating telescopes, there is a to improve the telescope sensitivity, it is necessary to reduce the cosmic ray background. Okay, so here I have said earlier that the electromagnetic cascade is developed, and similar cascades, similarly hadrons also, or cosmic rays also produces cascades. Okay, now here this one of this branch, okay, has pi zero, which becomes a gamma, and each one gamma gives a one electromagnetic cascade like this in the case of gamma like that. So this, in the case of hadronic shower, there are many such branches, many such cascades, because there is a transverse momentum of the secondaries within the nucleus also, the producers, they get spread out, all this kind of things happens. So it is like an Ashoka tree. This pure electromagnetic cascade goes like an Ashoka tree, whereas this one, like a banyan tree, it gets spread out, okay, some kind of thing. So in other sense, if you look at the, this is a Monte Carlo simulation, look at the footprint of the Cherenkov photons on the ground of an electromagnetic shower, it looks like this from a gamma ray. Okay, origin. Cosmic ray origin, it looks like that, of a different energy. Okay, this is 200 GeV proton, this is 50 GeV gamma. But see, unlike accelerator experiments, here in this kind of experiment, the incident beam, what you get is continuous energy. Okay, and the beam is of all particles. You have protons, you have alpha particles, CNO group, iron group, all other elements what you see in the periodic table. Okay, all those things are there. So then what, and the electrons also, positrons, electrons, all this. So then the job is to see which one is the gamma ray. Okay, so therefore, to do that, you have to separate out the both longitudinal development of the shower as well as the lateral distribution of the photon. You need hundreds of telescopes spread around and imaging telescopes. So obviously, an array of imaging telescope is obviously the best solution to go to achieve the higher sensitivity. So in that sense, in the near future, a project was started for the Cherenkov telescope array with hundreds of telescopes of various types, this for the lower energy, larger detectors, larger telescope size telescope, medium size telescope, and then for higher energy, lower small size telescopes distributed all around. It is done by many people belonging to 32 countries and things like that. Okay. In 2005, it was started, this project is, and it took time. They look for, the plan was to have two sites to cover, one in the northern sky, one in the southern sky. Okay, and various sites are chosen, and finally this La Palma site was chosen. Finally, this site. Similarly, for the southern sky, it is in a site in Chile, that is Paranal in Chile, that is chosen site. Okay. The project plan is like this, to have, originally we have to have a similar type of showers, similar towers of arrays, both south and north, but then the cost was so high, so they have to reduce it, and then they went for four large size telescopes, that red one here, for 23 meter diameter, 12 meter diameter green ones, 25 such telescopes, and then 4 meter such telescopes are 70 of them in the southern hemisphere. Southern hemisphere has a galactic center also, galactic and extragalactic science, whereas in the northern hemisphere mainly concentrated on the extragalactic science. So therefore, less number of telescopes will do. Of course, if one had money, one can put smaller size telescopes also can be added, and this array also can be expanded. So right now, in the last few years, a single prototype has been developed for each type. This is the large type, 23 meter diameter, a telescope. This is the 12 meter diameter, this telescope. There are two of them, one in Germany and one in America. And then there are three such prototypes of 4 meter diameter, class of 4 meter, small such mirrors. Now all these prototypes are ready, they are working, but now they have to be put into the actual site, and then validate of these prototypes, because we have to make a further copies of these telescopes. We need a large number, no? I said earlier, what is the number? 75 of small size telescopes like that, four of large ones. So 20 to 23, that validation of these prototypes. And then you build 23 to 27, build the array. This is the energy sensitivity. It is the energy from almost like 30 GeV to 300 TeV, four orders of magnitude in energy. And this is the typical existing telescopes. And this is an order of magnitude, a factor of 10 in higher, factor of 10 improvement in the sensitivity. And similarly, energy resolution and angular resolutions are much better now. And we can do a variety of science topics with that. Okay, it has a large collection area. One can do for search for pervertrons, cosmic ray accelerators like that. At lower energies, look for cosmology studies relevant to that. Okay, and transient. Whenever such a transient or gamma ray burst information you get, you need to rapidly orient all your telescopes. In 20 seconds, it can go to the point wherever it is. Okay, because the typical observation is you point the telescope into one object what you are looking at, and then you rotate the telescope at the same frequency as the rotation of Earth, so that you are all the time looking at that object. Okay. So the theme of detection is cosmic particle acceleration, how and where particles are accelerated, how do they propagate, and what is the impact in their environment like that, or probing the extreme universe or extreme environment, process of close to neutron stars or black holes, all these kind of things, and exploding. And physics beyond the standard model, like what is the nature of dark matter? If dark matter decays into photons, you would be able to detect them. Okay. Similarly, do axion like particle exist? That is, some of the models where the axions can oscillate to photons like that. So in that case, axion photons oscillations. In that case, okay, if you, it started as axion but ended as a photon, you can detect them, things like that. Okay, so these are some more, I'm running out of time, and this is some more various types of galactic objects like that to give you a little more flavor of some of the results or some of the ways. This is one of the things about the Crab pulsar, very well studied Crab pulsar at all wavelengths. Starting from radio to this one, it X-rays, radio, optical, like that. It's one cycle, one big cycle of this pulsar. One rotation gives here as a phase. Okay, starting from 0 to 1 or -2 to 0.8. So this position at P1 and P2 are the two peaks. One can see as the beam is pointing towards us. Like that. These are the two positions. It is happening from radio to gamma rays at all. Now here, the rest what is there, the gamma rays comes, photons coming along the beam, they comes populated into only two, these two, and maybe little bit in the between the two peaks, position, pulse positions. But in other positions, okay, it is all cosmically background. It is coming. So to test that, this kind of things. We also had made, looked at the telescope, oriented the telescope into a random position, okay, almost like a crab position at the same atmospheric depth and other things like that to have the same energy threshold. There are no point sources of this. There is no crab pulsar there. So it's a crab pulsar has 33 millisecond periodicity. Now, same periodicity you use and you analyze the data, you see it's all random noise. So, basically, cosmic rays, they can come at any time. So they are not periodic with 33 milliseconds like that. So they become almost enough. There is nothing seen in these two pulse positions where you expect gamma rays. Okay. Similarly, the MAGIC telescope also has seen, originally it was thought that this kind of pulsars cannot emit gamma rays of more than something like 30 GV or 90 GV like that, it can't give numbers like that. But now we can see that it can go to almost like 1 TeV. Okay, it has, there is the evidence that this kind of signal is seen from the pulsars like that. Then the other type of class of objects are active galactic nuclei. This is active galactic nuclei means there is a galaxy, there's a supermassive black hole at the center of the galaxy. It is accreting matter, and this matter is accreted and then thrown out. Okay, this process of why it throws out and how it is thrown out is not known, but it is known that, okay, this kind of jets are being generated. Okay, there is a magnetic instability takes place, and then matter is gets thrown out. It's a jet, both in the forward direction as well as in the backward direction. So it is not shown here. Similarly, here also, forward direction as well as in the backward direction. Okay, that can be generated. In this, jets, accelerated particles can come, protons, electrons like that, and they can produce gamma rays also. They need not be continuously there. Sometimes they can be short-lived also, because this, as the matter is thrown out, ejected, just like our solar flares like that, it happens occasionally. Okay, one such example is in the southern hemisphere, which is observed by the Hess Observatory. You can see here, for 100 minutes, it is shown in the x-axis is the time. Okay, in 100 minutes, the flux increased enormously. Okay, this is about 0.3 or so. It went to 3.5, so almost like 10 to 12 times higher. And then there's a fine variations, very fine variations within that. So this kind of things will point back to astrophysics of how these are generated, and that should be in a very small region. Then only you can get a very such sharp peaks or sharp rise times like that. Okay. Then there are other results, like not fully confirmed, maybe, that is, photons of different energy, like 150 to 250 GV to what 10 TeV, so different energies, they do not come at the same time. They should come at the same time, but if they come at a little delayed, so it means that the dispersion as the energy of in the photon velocity as the energy. Okay, it has a Lorentz invariance, it has implications of that. So limit on the validity of the Lorentz invariance function put. So here the blazars, okay, blazars are the one again, active galactic nuclei with the black hole at the center, and the jets are emitted. And if the jets is pointed in our direction, okay, we can look at it like that. Such jets, the spectral energy distribution is plotted here versus wavelength here. Here, wavelength multiplied by the flux is put, and it has a two-type structure. There are many curves here, but concentrate only on one curve, because this is important, because there is a different class of objects like this, as depending upon where its peak is. Okay, classified as LBL, IBL, HBL, like that, doesn't matter. But the basic thing is, it has a structure of one peak like this, and second thing like that. That is basically, the first one is mostly synchrotron emission. Okay. High energy electrons, they emit synchrotron radiation. That is, the synchrotron emission is coming like this. And in the second peak is the inverse Compton scattering. That is, the synchrotron photons by the same electrons which produce this synchrotron emission. It is called self in Compton scattering, like that. And it can give a higher. In that case, this, it is called leptonic model. In that case, because its electrons are involved, so it is in this case, this both gamma rays photons and X-ray photons, they are related. Okay, so if X-ray, if some variation takes place in the X-rays, gamma rays also it will take place like that. Or if instead of this happening, if the synchrotron photons in this kind of situations in the jet, there are also protons are accelerated. Okay, synchrotron emission, electrons are more sensitive because their mass is much lower compared to proton. Then But protons can interact and produce pi zeros, and these pi zeros can decay, then the energy spectrum would be different. Okay, like this. It's called hadronic model. So depending upon the spectrum of whether it is electronic or hadronic, one has to identify looking at the energy spectrum of spectral energy distributions. Okay, like that. So many objects we can do it like that. Then in one such attempt, this one, normally one zone is enough to explain most of the active galactic nuclei. Let's say one peak, and then the synchrotron Compton effect, it will produce a second peak like that. But in this case, the one was not adequate. One had to use it on two such sources. Okay. So similarly, bright AGNs could be monitored with Haggar or any other telescope. Haggar telescopes greater than 200 GeV, but other telescopes can be even at lower energy also can do. And then in this one, Markarian 421 is one such active galactic nuclei blazar. It could be fitted by the widely accepted single zone self synchrotron self Compton model. But whereas the other two objects like 501, Markarian 501, or this object 1ES 1959 plus 750, this is the right ascension and declination of this to find out its coordinate of this source, need multi zone emission models. So basically, widely accepted single zone essentially not always adequate to understand broadband emission mechanisms of the blazar. So it is not enough to measure this kind of objects only with one gamma rays or anything. You need gamma rays, X-rays, optical, infrared, radio also. Basically, the wide band, multi-wavelength band observations are needed to understand exactly how particle emission takes place, what exactly is happening in this kind of. So to summarize, what is gamma ray astronomy is a modern interdisciplinary research field in the interface of astronomy, physics and cosmology. It addresses diverse topics related to non-thermal universe, acceleration, propagation and radiation of ultra-relativistic particles. Generally, under extreme physical conditions in the environment, characterized with the huge gravitational, magnetic and electrical fields, highly excited media, shock waves, and very often associated with the relativistic bulk motions, linked in particular to jets in black holes, microquasars or gamma ray bursts like that, and cold ultra-relativistic pulsar waves. It deals with galactic astronomy, extragalactic astronomy, and cosmology, contains information about both relativistic electrons and hadrons. In short, earlier, it was an advanced branch of particle astrophysics with a goal for searching for few sources of cosmic rays. Because when it started this field, from ground-based gamma ray astronomy started from the cosmic ray physicists, and at that time they were puzzled that how these cosmic rays are accelerated, which are the objects which are emitting cosmic rays, so they want to search for them. So they thought that there may be very few objects which can give this kind of cosmic ray accelerations, and that is how they started searching for them. But one has not yet pinpointed such cosmic ray cases. But there is a large evidence that supernova remnants are the ideal pool for the cosmic ray, bulk of the cosmic ray accelerations and other things like that. There are other candidates also. But now, a new branch of astronomy, this gamma ray astronomy is a new branch of astronomy with diverse objects. So let me end. I'm already crossed my time limit. Let me end. To summarize, gamma ray astrophysics is a rapidly growing field. Many advances in understanding the underlying high energy phenomena have been taken place, but still lacking firm evidence on cosmic ray origin. We still don't know exactly which particular object is the origin for the cosmic rays. More and more TV sources are being found as the telescopes have been working, more telescopes have been added, all those things happening. Now overlapping observations with the satellite-borne detectors and ground instruments are now possible. Okay, what happened is satellite-borne detectors, they have increased their energy, they have come up to 1 TeV. The ground-based observatories, they have added, become bigger and bigger telescopes, larger and larger telescopes, and they have brought down their energy, come to something like 20-30 GeV like that. So there is a lot of overlapping between satellite-based and ground-based detector. But as I said earlier, the a single ground-based detector or single means a single establishment or single observatory can detect the source only for 6 hours. Okay. Similarly, in the satellite-borne also, the Fermilab, it in one orbit it covers the entire sky. Okay. Because they keep on looking at different things. But most of the time, a given object may be seen for several hours only. Okay. Major boost to the field is from the Fermilab satellite observations. And then CTA is our, in the ground-based gamma ray astronomy, it is CTA is the next observatory. It is an ambition project in the near future. If it should have been operated originally, planned to get operated by 2020, by now, but various other problems and other things came up, and funding situation also. Now with the corona also, I don't know what is the funding situation in various places. It may further delay, but right now the plan is by 2027 the observatory would be complete. But the observation would start even with the single telescope, the prototype telescope, which is now getting installed in the actual site. They will start doing the observations. Okay, so we can say that from now onwards, as more and more telescopes are getting added, more and more results are going to come. Okay, so this is a class of various objects. Thank you very much. Okay, I am ready for questions.
Thank you, Prof. Acharya, for very nicely summarizing the entire Indian history, and also bringing up lots of milestones in the gamma ray astronomy, particularly from the experimental point of view, but also bringing up various challenges, and particularly mentioning about CTA, which is the, as you rightly said, the most ambitious project in this line. But on the way, also stressing the point that now these experiments and the topics of research have become quite interdisciplinary, and various detectors looking at different kind of physics are actually collaborating for observations as well as the physics. And obviously also the challenges that one had building such large systems technologically, of course, money, and also the collaboration strengths, and so on and so forth. So thank you very much. I would now request people with who want to ask questions to raise their hand in the Zoom, and on the YouTube, you can type in your questions, and I'll come back and read the question for you. So first, let me take a question from Shailesh from Zoom platform. Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, am I audible?
Yeah.
I have few questions.
Okay.
First is, like, on several ground-based experiments, to remove the background, our experiment is built quite a few hundreds of meters or thousands of meters underground. But on the space-based telescope, that is not possible. So how efficient is background cancellation on space-based telescopes?
Space-based telescopes, background elimination is quite good in the sense they have an active detector. Okay, the charged particles are being detected
directly.
Directly, yeah.
Okay, and my other question is, some of the ground-based telescopes were facing the sky at an angle so that they are looking at a particular object.
Yeah,
in case we want to map the whole sky, would it be more efficient to face those telescopes straight up in the sky?
No. these are tracking telescopes. You can orient it to any position in the sky. Okay? Anything, north, west, south, west, east, any point in the sky. That is shown at an angle. That's all. We can make it vertical. We can change it to any angle. And we already know the coordinate of the source where we want to observe in the sky. We don't point the telescope to unknown positions. We know the position of the expected from the other wavelength, like radio, X-rays, other objects like that. Okay? And then you track. While tracking, it can go even up to 20 degrees altitude like that. We can keep tracking from this one. Then after detecting one source, observing one source for some time, and you change the orientation of the telescope to some other object. So all these things, it is like optical telescope also like that. That is, you can go to any point in the sky, orient to that, and then you have to track it. That is, you can't keep the telescope stationary. You have to track it in the same speed with which Earth is rotating, so that this object is always at the center of your telescope. Okay? Is that clear?
Yeah. My question is, in case of a known source, it is easy to point the telescope towards it. But let's say we are expecting something from an unknown source, we don't know its position. So what is generally the plan for that?
Oh, okay. For the general plan for the unknown sources is to operate a wide angle telescope. Like for example, UTI, not telescope, that UTI Earth Array, or similarly, there are the other water-based Cherenkov detector arrays are there. Okay. That kind of wide angle telescopes, if you keep, then you can detect from all directions coming. In this space, for example, gamma ray burst, this Fermi lat does not detect that many gamma ray bursts. But in the same Fermi satellite, there is a gamma ray burst detector. Okay, that kind of detector are there in the astrosat also. They have very wide angle pipe. So there are two, three such detectors they put, and then they see from what angle it has come. And then they try to give a rough idea of where its location is. Then all other people with the very fine resolutions, they point out to that direction and do it. That is only afterwards to see the afterglow or this. But if they move very fast, sometimes it was possible, they could see when certain thing has developed, some burst has come, and the burst has not yet died, they are still able to observe. Okay?
Yeah. Thank
Is that
you.
Clear?
And, yeah. And I have one last question.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. The mirror-based telescopes which are used, we need an additional, the photomultipliers are mounted on at an additional height. Instead, if correct. We use lens-based telescope, the photomultipliers will be needed maybe at ground or somewhere below the ground. So would it not be logistically more favorable?
Not the lens based. It doesn't matter whether it is mounted up or down. Okay. It is still accessible and it is not the problem. And it is light sensors can be photomultipliers, and nowadays even the silicon PMs also being used. There are some telescopes I showed you. There are two types of mirrors. Two mirror designs are there. I will just show you once again that one. In that case, here, for example, this one, okay, in the US, what is it? It is the one mirror here. In the center of this mirror, there is a hole. And then this is the second mirror. This mirror light is focused on this, and then from here it is not focused, it is just reflected, and from here it is focused to this one, and in this place you can mount the camera.
Yeah.
Okay. It is possible to do that. It is a double mirror system. But whereas it's a single mirror, so then you have to put the photo multipliers at a larger distance.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay.
Very.
Yeah.
Thanks, Sailesh, for your nice questions. I have one or two questions on the face on the YouTube as well, Acharya. This is Shiv Shankar Shikdar. It says, do the binary black hole mergers or binary neutron star mergers emit gamma rays?
Yes.
Carry out multi messenger observations, gravitational and gamma rays for BBH and BNS mergers, as we can do GW plus radio.
Yeah.
Okay. So, maybe the first question could start. Say, do the binary black hole mergers or binary neutron star mergers emit gamma rays?
Yes, they do emit gamma rays, and that takes place as a gamma ray burst. They do not emit continuously, because once the merger takes place, during that time it emits. It emits a very bright gamma ray source. It becomes a very bright gamma ray source. It emits. So that is being picked up by the Fermi satellite. Okay, that is the in the Fermi satellite there are detectors for gamma ray burst detectors called GBM, gamma ray burst detectors, and they pick up. That is how all these gamma ray bursts are picked up. They are mostly lower energy. Okay, their spectrum do extend to higher energy also, but mostly up to lower energy. Also, sometimes if they happen to be in the same within the field of view, they are able to detect. So it happens to both in the it comes as a one burst once. Just like in the gravitational wave experiment also.
Experiments.
Yeah.
Okay. He has another question, but that's not exactly. It says, can we carry out multi-messenger observations, gravitational waves and gamma rays for BBH and BNS mergers as we do gravitational plus radio?
That is right. See, multi-messenger things are needed. Recently, when the gravitational wave detection they give a time at what time and what angle from what direction it has come. Then the people who have observed happen to be whoever had their telescope observing in that direction. They look back their data. Okay, they look back their data and they see it. Okay. There is some possibility of Fermi satellite also looking at this, getting some signal from the gravitational wave detected source. Okay. It is possible, and it's needed also to get a full control on the astrophysics of what is happening. You need to have a multi-wavelength observations at all possible wavelengths.
Okay. So that, Acharya, I think we don't have any more questions. So so I would like, there's one question just now popped up. Just a minute. Hariom, can you unmute and ask question?
Yeah, hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yes.
Sir, my question is northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere, we are having different telescopes. Are they triggered? Is the trigger same for all this? If some detector knows there is something in that particular direction, so how they send the information?
No. This northern hemisphere, you look at different sky compared to southern sky. Okay, southern hemisphere you can't unless you have a nearby detector, then you can see the same object. But same object also, if it comes and if you want a same shower, same gamma ray coming and producing the shower like that. That is like in Hanle, what we have a Hager experiment, and then BRC is now putting a MACE experiment, a huge telescope. Now all those telescopes which are there, they see the same shower. they see the same shower. Okay, gamma ray produces the shower, they see. Otherwise, same source, they can simultaneously see only if they are in the same longitudinal belt. Like in Hanley, and there are some other experiments in Russia. Okay, they have, they are more or less in the same latitude, longitude. Okay, different latitude, but longitude is same. So therefore, they can see the same object somewhat simultaneously. Otherwise, what happens is when somebody sees it, and after a few hours, the other fellow can pick up.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Just following up from their previous question from again Shiv Shankar. Normally, what will be the time frame typically means between gamma ray, gravitational wave, and gamma emissions? I mean, he's saying typically, like, what is the time frame between them so that maybe one can look for signals triggered by one, or at least data, and then after that, you look in other.
See, okay. Oh, my understanding is the thing is the time frame is. The gravitational wave, you have to first see it, okay? And then you have to analyze the data to understand that, to remove the noise and other. It is not that immediately you see it and within a few seconds, you can tell that, declare that it is a gravitational wave, because there is lot of other noises also there. They have to see in a different other telescopes. They have to analyze the data and tell that. Everybody in astronomy, they will be detecting the GPS clock time, okay? Because it is very much necessary, because this, depending upon what your coordinate, at what time you have seen, then you can find out from what direction it has come, then only you can point out to point in the sky where it is. Then the other fellows also can accordingly can look at in their data at that time from that angle. Whether they have data or not. So that is how it is done.
Okay. I guess maybe even if you look at the data subsequently offline, he meant to say, like, what is the time frame within which you should look for a signal which is, you know, one triggered by the other or something. Maybe.
No. See, that is also like. There are no, it all depends upon the model. Okay. First thing is you look for at the same time. Okay. You look for same time. Okay. Then you try to put a little delay here and there because you don't know what is the time for the photon to arrive, neutrino to arrive, or what is the time for the gravitational wave to arrive. Okay. So therefore, you have to keep on scanning your data up to some time. Then you can say your conclusion is, okay, I have looked at, this is the time supposed to have come if it is simultaneous with the gravitational wave. But I have seen so many days or so many hours before or so many hours after, like that. But I don't see any signal like that, or I found some. And if they find exactly some signal at some time like that, and many such things happen, then only that subject will build up at what is the delay. Right now, it's all model and theoretical understanding of what could be the delay. But you can't use only that delay. You first search with that kind of expected delay. But then, as a experimentally, you have so much other time and other windows also to find out, to prove what exactly the real delay.
Relative pattern.
Yeah.
Okay. So, okay, Acharya, thanks a lot. So, once again, on behalf of all the participants, we would like to thank you for your very nice talk and also taking up good discussion and questions at the end. I hope all the participants had a good feel for what the field is like today on the gamma ray. And particularly what to look for beyond in the world of interdisciplinary and, you know, people using different kind of detectors. As you said at the end, trying to collate the data, and that's what I think making the whole field very interesting. So with that, let me thank you once again. And I also want to remind our participants that the next talk in this series is going to be day after tomorrow. It's going to be given by Patrick Dasgupta from Delhi University. So please come back at 6 o'clock on Friday. So until that time, take care and stay safe. Thank you, everybody.
Okay, Satya. And thank you.
Yeah, and, thanks, Acharya.
Is the speech is clear or it is...
Yeah, it's clear. Except